Good evening, all of you. Welcome to the Friday Bible study. I know that some of you were eagerly waiting for this study. And thank you so much for the interest, the desire, the passion that you show to learn the Word of God. So let's start with a prayer, acknowledging that we can't do this without Him. We need you, Holy Spirit of God. We can't do this without you. Totally dependent on you, Holy Spirit. You are the helper. You are the teacher. Help us, all of us. Help all of us today to understand your word and to apply your word. Yes, Holy Spirit of God, give us the wisdom to apply the word so that we will be good stewards of what you have entrusted to us. We are sitting at your feet to learn this evening, and we are ready to receive. Impart to us truths that will set us free. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Okay, so your body today is going to be the final part, part three. And next week, as I said on Wednesday, that I'm taking a break. So next week, we will not have the Tuesday and the Wednesday Bible study. Wednesday and the Friday Bible study. First week of July, Devanka will start the Friday Bible study and I will do the Wednesday Bible study. So Wednesday Bible study, I'm starting a new topic. The topic is the limits of our liberty. I will explain to you what it is on Sunday, okay? What the study is regarding what the limits of our liberty, the limits of our liberty. I will explain to you on Sunday. So let's get into the study. Last week, we stopped at 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. Let's begin from there. What we are looking at? We are looking at our body, your body and my body. It's how important. Now, by now, you must understand how important is your body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You're not your own. You need to underline that you are, your body is not your own. Verse 20 says that he bought it. Jesus bought your body. Say, Jesus bought my body. On the cross, he paid not with perishable items of silver and gold to buy you. He bought you with imperishable blood of his own, priceless blood. He paid it and you bought your body. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Understand, you and I, we need to honor God with this body. Are you hearing me? Verse 19 says, know that you're not your own. Why? Someone else has bought your body. You know, during the Old Testament times, slaves were bought. Okay? Slaves, you know, the master pays the money and buys a slave. And whoever the master has paid money for that slave has to do whatever the master says. The slave does not have freedom. The slave does not have liberty, saying, I will have a 1 hour nap today. Today I can't work. You know, he has no liberty, no freedom to say whatever he wants. He is a possession of the master who paid money to buy this slave, and that slave is submitted to master's command. But precious child of God, understand that Jesus paid the price for you. He bought you. He bought your body. But he does not treat you like a slave. He treats you as a son and a daughter. Therefore, what happens today is the children of God takes liberty to mishandle this body. If God had master-slave mentality, you can't do whatever you want with your body. But God is a father, not a master. Therefore, he has given liberty to you to do whatever you want to do with your body. So what happens today is, we as the children of God, some of us, we do not know that we have been bought at a price, that we belong to Jesus Christ. Can we go to verse 19, Sean, please? You are not your own. That means you are not the owner of this body, so you can't do whatever you want to do. Because Father has given you liberty, you're doing whatever you want to do. But taking care of this body is very, very, very important. You know, some of you take care of your television more than your body. Some of you take care of your vehicle well more than your body. We misuse this body. Some of you put inside of your body things that your body should never have. If God wants you to smoke, he would have created you with a chimney. Why didn't God put a chimney on your head? Is because he didn't want you to send smoke. Are you hearing me, precious people of God? So let us not mishandle our body. Some of you eat like you have never seen food. There is a limit that your body can handle. So then after that you fall sick. And then you say, Lord, what have you done to me? I prayed and fasted and prayed. I did that. I did this. I gave offering to the church. I came on Sundays, but you mishandled your body. You didn't sleep well. You know, you were eating all kind of junk food, and you know, you were mishandling your body. You know, you have no right to tattoo your body, because your body does not belong to you. How can you pierce your body? Now, people will argue with me for this. How dare you to say, this is my body, I can do whatever I want? Who said? Read the Bible. You do not know, because God is gracious, God is merciful, God is kind, he does not punish you because he's a father, but he has bought your body with a price. So, if you're under the sound of my voice, please, you know, I'm talking to myself, not only you. It's pricking me. It's a double-edged sword. It's convicting me. I feel guilty when I'm teaching to you, because I'm also at fault. I'm also at the receiving end. So let us look after our bodies. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. So I spoke to the women last week. Women, please don't expose your body. If you want to expose your body, show it only to your husband, not to every man on the street and anywhere, you know, wherever you go. And, you know, once I was advising a girl, you know, she you know what her answer is? This is my body. If that man does, I can dress the way I want. What about him? He'll ask him to close his eyes and go. You know, that's an answer. I can do whatever I want to do with my body. I can't change myself because that fellow is falling into sin and looking at my body. Ask him to control his body. You know, that was the answer. Precious people of God, the truth, what men and women don't understand is that their body does not belong to them. It belongs to him. He paid a price. So you will have to give account of your body. I showed it last week. Am I right? Now go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. let's take from verse 13 onwards. You say, food for stomach and the stomach for food. God will destroy them both. So Paul is saying, in other words, you know, food is created for stomach and stomach is created for food. So what's the big deal of eating? But, you know, in the same way, some argue today, sex is created for body and body is created for sex. What's the big deal of me sleeping around? Precious people, that's what Paul is talking about. Now watch, Paul is saying, you say, food for the stomach and stomach for the food. And God will destroy them both. The body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality. Now, husband and wife, now don't stop doing sex. Sex is permitted within the boundary of marriage. Paul is talking about sexual immorality. The body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. My goodness, can you see? And the Lord for the body. The primary purpose of your body is for the Lord. Then comes everything else. Why the primary purpose that you got a body is not for food, not for sex, but for the Lord. Next verse, Sean. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? So understand this. When you're part of the church, okay? Christ is the head. I could be the neck. Sean could be the hand. Insta could be the leg. We are part, members of Christ, members of Christ himself. That means you are a part of Christ's body. Then, shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with the prostitute? So if, listen to me, precious child of God. If a man or a woman is in the church, if he goes and sleeps with a prostitute, he's engaging Christ also into that. Because Christ, you are part of Christ's body. Read it with me. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Now my body has hand, legs, ears, nose. Now, if I go and indulge in sexual immorality, not, watch my words, don't misquote me. When, I am not saying when, if, I will never, by God's grace, by his mercy. I'm just giving you an example because I can't take anybody for example. They'll get offended with me. If I get involved with a prostitute, which will never happen by his grace, my hand can't say, oh, now I'm not a part of this. Or my ears can't say, I'm not part of this. The whole body engages in the act. In the same way, when you are part of a church, Jesus is the head. Sean could be the legs, I could be the hand, Insta could be the neck. And if one person in the church goes and sleeps with a prostitute, is engaging the whole church. Are you seeing what I'm saying? You are engaging Christ also. That's what Paul is saying. Watch here. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Never. Underline that never in your Bible. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said, the two will become one flesh. Precious child of God. Understand this. You know, sexual immorality. When you sleep with a woman, you become one with that woman. You can say one standoff night, it's over. No, you have become one with that woman. There is an exchange that happens when you sleep with a woman or a man. The bodies become one. This is why it's how dangerous, you know, sleeping around. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her? You might, you know, men or women who sleep, you know, today sex has become very casual. It has become something very normal. It's like eating burger in McDonald's now today. Offices are become so immoral. Having casual sex while you are married to a person is nothing today in offices. And even the office environment or the management some encourages these kinds of things, though, so that people will work and stay more hours in office. So what happens is, when you sleep with a person and you wake up in the morning and they say bye and you move out, you do not know you have become one with that person, and there is an exchange that has happened. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said the two will become one flesh. That's why sex is only confined within the framework of marriage, because otherwise you will become one with the other person. So you are part of Christ, you are part of the church, you're part of Christ's body, and then you sleep with a prostitute. You are even dragging Christ into it. It's dangerous, precious child of God. Protect your body. Keep your body clean, because you have to give account to God. Are you with me? I hope that you're with me. Next verse, Sean. But whoever is united with the Lord is one with him in spirit. So when the Holy Spirit comes inside of you, he's one with your spirit. But, and then becomes his, your temple, your body hosts the Holy Spirit of God. And then you go and unite it with a prostitute. It is not acceptable. Next verse. Flee from sexual immorality. Watch this, precious children of God. All other sins a person commits are outside the body. But whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Okay. Next verse. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. So understand this. Your primary purpose of your body is the body is the Lord's. This body that is given to you by God, purchased by the blood of Jesus, is for the primary purpose of hosting God's presence. So therefore, do not defile your body. Are you with me? Your body was designed for God to dwell in. The Bible says that God does not dwell in man-made buildings. So no matter how beautiful the architecture or how expensive the structure of a building, God is not interested. Your body is his temple. The Holy Spirit came down to the earth is to live in your body, not in these beautiful structured cathedrals and temples and, you know, churches. No, he is interested in your body. So when God's people meet, there will be God, but he does not live there. Okay, so when we meet on a Sunday in a building, God may manifest in that place. God will be there, But he does not live there. He lives inside of you. He lives inside of me. So he has designed his own temple. And that temple is your own body. Take care of this body, precious child of God. You know, so when man fell into sin, every area of man became corrupt. His spirit was corrupted. His soul was corrupted, his body was corrupted. Physically, mentally, spiritually, man was corrupted. And the end of physical corruption was death. The sting of sin is death. That's how death came into the body. You know, when sin is there in your body, understand your body is decaying. Listen to me, precious child of God. God created Adam and Eve for eternity. He never created Adam and Eve's body to decay, to wear out. Do you understand what I'm saying? When God created Adam and Eve, their bodies were created not to decay. But why today our bodies are wearing out? Why our bodies are, you know, decaying is, you know, day by day is because sin entered. So the more you keep your body away from sin, the more you preserve your body from sin, your deterioration will be very slow. Are you with me, precious child of God? Keep your body sanctified. Keep your body separated for the Lord. The more you separate your body for the Lord, the more he will cause it to appreciate him in every way. Amen. 1 Peter 2:24 says, Jesus took our sins, our curses, and our sicknesses upon his body. Now watch here. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. So can you see the healing and sin? Peter is connecting. The well-being of your body to thrive and the body to do well, distance your body from sin. Because the decay of our body started because of sin. The moment sin entered, death entered. Because death entered, decay set in our bodies. So sin and the decay of our bodies are connected, precious child of God. This is why the more we sanctify ourselves, separate ourselves and take care of our body, healing and restoration happens faster. Are you with me, precious child of God? So however, Jesus died to redeem us, not part of us. He didn't die to redeem only your souls. He redeemed the whole man, spirit, soul, and body. He redeemed the whole man. So as far as God is concerned, everything is finished on the cross regarding the redemption of our total self. So there ain't God to do anything right now. He has finished everything. It is maintaining of what is done already. Are you hearing me? God has done everything possible and everything, whatever that needs to be done for the well-being of your body, redemption of your body. Now what we need to do is maintain. So why a lot of Christians, children of God, fall sick or their body deteriorates because lack of maintenance. You live a holy life. You keep away from sin. You protect yourself from sin. But where we go wrong is maintenance. Because God has done everything. He has restored you. He has redeemed you and restored you. And now He has given you. But you need to maintain. Any electrical equipment, you have to maintain. Your vehicle, you have to maintain. Your mobile, you have to maintain. Your phone, you have to maintain. Your iPad, you have to maintain. Everything you have to maintain. If you don't maintain, it's going to deteriorate. So this is where our precious child of God, the children of God, go wrong. Maintaining your body is your responsibility. And also, let me say this. If you have fallen sick, listen to me very carefully. Don't misunderstand me. If your body falls sick, there is nothing wrong in going to a doctor. Unless the Lord says, Rajah, don't go to the doctor. I have healed you. Don't touch medication. I don't want you to take medication. I have healed you. If God specifically speaks to you and tells you, don't go. Don't touch medication. If not, for God's sake, take and live long. I have seen some good Christians, good servants of God, ignorantly dying early, foolishly dying early. Because why? No, I will not take medication. I will not go to the doctor. Where they could have served another 20, 30 years more and they die early due to ignorance and negligence. If maintaining your body is your responsibility, precious child of God, if God has not told you that don't take medication, if you do not have the grace to live on divine health, take, for God's sake, take medication and live long little more and serve God than dying early. I get sometimes angry with people for their foolishness and ignorance. Sometimes what happens is they look at some servants of God and they live on divine health because they have built their grace to that level. Whatever that you try to do spiritually, if you do not have the level of grace, don't attempt it. Don't copy somebody and try to do it when you don't have that level of grace. So if you have not built and if you do not have the level of grace to walk in divine health, take medication if your body is sick and heal your body, maintain your body. Live long. I hope that I am clear. But if you have built your faith level and you have the grace to walk in divine health, please live in divine health. Precious child of God, God has healed me. God has healed me. I will not take medication and dying is not bringing glory to God. Are you hearing me? Oh, God has healed me. I will not touch medication. I will not go to the doctor. And next day you have died. Do you think that brings glory to God? No. And there is nothing to be ashamed of saying I've gone to the doctor and taken medication. Where in the Bible, tell me, show me that it says don't go to the doctor. So maintaining your body, taking care of your body is your responsibility. When Timothy was sick, he was a pastor in the Ephesian church. Paul says, Timothy, now enough that you took water, take some wine. Whereas Timothy would have said, Timothy, divine health. God has died for you. Don't touch. Live with the divine health without medication. Come on, people of God. Take care of your body. If you don't have that faith level, if you don't have grown your faith or your grace level to live in divine health, put some medicine, heal your body, and serve God. I hope some are going to get really angry with me. You know, precious child of God, I know there is a realm called divine health, and I believe in the realm called divine health. I don't say this. I can't remember the day that I have gone to a doctor. Only by His grace for any sickness. So I am not a person who say no, there is no divine health. No, I believe in it. I operate in it. But what I say is, if you have not built your grace, you don't have the grace to walk in divine health. You don't have the faith level. Don't attempt it. Just take some medication and live happily and healthy. Okay, so not that I am a person who does not believe in divine health. Okay, so I hope that I'm very clear. My goodness, today, can I finish this? So as far as New Testament is concerned, it is healing is past. From the time of death of Jesus, healing is done. Okay, so I'm not that I don't believe in divine health. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 23. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 23. We have lost some good people due to lack of ignorance and negligence. That should never happen. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. May God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. Can you see? Sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now Paul is saying, may God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. So what happens is sometimes we fall, we sin. That's why he says sanctify you through and through. So there are times, you know, the righteous may fall 7 times, but God restores him. So, yes, we don't plan for it. Sometimes we sin, we fall, but he sanctifies us through again and through, again and through. He sanctifies so that you repent and return to God immediately when you fall and keep your body blameless. You don't start the day pre-planning and pre-positioning yourself to sin. You start the day with saying, I'm going to live righteous for God. I'm going to live blameless for God. And then you slip and fall. He will sanctify you when you immediately repent. True repentance opens door for forgiveness and restoration. Okay? So it's our responsibility to keep our body blameless when Christ comes. That's what the scripture is saying. You know, 1 Corinthians 6:20 says, please therefore glorify God in your body. Please honor God in your body. It is very important to understand that Jesus redeemed the whole person, not only your spirit. He redeemed your body also from sin. So you have to present it blameless to him when he comes, because it doesn't belong to you. You have to give account of your body and you need to honor God. You know, one important reason why he redeemed the body, that it will become the temple of the Holy Spirit. Okay? So if he didn't redeem your body, Holy Spirit will not dwell in there. The body was redeemed by the blood of Jesus. This is what the simple thing that God expects from us. What? Keep our body clean so that the Holy Spirit can dwell and enjoy his stay. That we do not grieve him, that we will not quench him. Do you like to live in a house that is messed with stinking garbage and cockroaches running and cobwebs and dirty water leaking and bathroom smelling? Do you like to live in a house like that? Do you like to? I don't like to. So let not your body be like that for the Holy Spirit, because that is your house. Let not your body be so dirty that the Holy Spirit is disgusted in staying in there. Keep your body clean. That is his house, the Holy Spirit of God's house. Romans 12:1 says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. Underline those words. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Okay, so what is true and proper worship? Not singing beautiful song with superb guitar and a perfect chord arrangement. If all of that is done and if your body is not clean and holy, your worship is useless. Because read, precious child of God, what is your true and proper worship? What is your true and proper worship? Presenting your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. So if you don't present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, but you're singing so beautifully and with beautiful music and chords, God is not pleased with that worship. He wants first, this is your true and proper worship. So body is important in worship. Understand how important your body is in worship. Taking care of your body is very important, precious child of God. So for all what he has done for us, what he's expecting from us, to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the Holy Spirit of God. For him to live peacefully, for him to live happily, for him to enjoy his stay, that he is not quenched, he is not grieved. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. You know, what does it mean by present your bodies as a living sacrifice? In the Old Testament, you know, the animal is placed on the altar. The sacrificial animal is placed on the altar, and that animal does not have any freedom. It is now dedicated to the Lord on the altar. The animal cannot do whatever it wants to do. Now, in the same way, in the New Testament, Paul is saying, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, that no longer animal, it is your body that has to be placed on the altar as a living. The Old Testament, the animal is killed and placed on the altar. But here, we are living, but yet we are placing our bodies on the altar so that we will not do whatever our body wants to do. Are you with me, precious child of God? I hope that you are hearing what I'm saying. So every day when you get up, your body should be a living sacrifice on the altar. Therefore, it will be holy. Because if you don't place your body as a living sacrifice on the altar, your body will crave for so many things, demand for so many things. Just understand the craving of your Holy Spirit, a craving of your body rather. If you want to really know the craving of your body, just fast and see how it will crave for your food. You know, if some of you, if you were addicted to pornography, if you stopped it, watch and see how much these eyes will crave for pornography. This body is craving for the earthly things, for the immoral things. So placing your body on the altar as a living sacrifice daily is important so that you can present it to God, the Holy Spirit, holy. I hope that you are receiving, precious child of God. God says, give me your body. I will take care of it. You know, God wants us to give the ownership of our body. Because if you understand this reality, listen to me, if you understand this truth, that this body does not belong to you, that you are only a steward, He is the owner, then placing your body on the altar is easy. Because when you try to take ownership of your body, that's when you say, I will do whatever I want because this is my body. But if you understand this truth, that this is not mine, this belongs to the Lord, I am a steward, He is the owner, placing your body on the altar is easy. And when you place it on the altar, listen to me, precious child of God, as a living sacrifice, God will take care of your body. God will preserve your body. God will nourish your body. God will bless your body. Are you with me? You know, that's why Jesus wasn't even bothered who's going to bury him after his death. He didn't ask Peter, hey, make sure, man, after I die, make sure you find a good coffin and reserve a plot at Jayaratna, the general cemetery, and order the best coffin. He was not bothered. You bury me or do whatever, I don't care. Because he knew this body does not belong to him, that when he presents it on the altar, he knew that God the Father will take care of it. You with me, precious child of God? So when you present your body on the altar as a living sacrifice, you don't decide on your body what it does. Are you with me? Romans chapter 8 verse 10 and 11. Romans chapter 8 verse 10 and 11. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. Okay? And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you. So, precious child of God, when the Holy Spirit is in you, okay, listen to me very carefully. When your body has become the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit of God, if you learn the art of keeping your body every day on the altar as a living sacrifice, the Holy Spirit, and then you preserve your body blameless, holy, the Holy Spirit will keep releasing life. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you. Learn the art of putting your body on the altar every day and say, Lord, this morning, thank you so much for giving this new day for me. By the grace of you, I have seen this day, God. And now I am putting my flesh as a living sacrifice on the altar, holy and blameless. Father, this body does not belong to me. Here is it. I'm placing it on the altar today, God. I want to please you with my body. Then the Holy Spirit will release life to your body. Because now you understand the principle of ownership and steward. Amen. Psalm 107, verse 17 and 20. Can we have it in KJV, Sean? Psalm 107, verse 17 to 20. Fools, because of their transgressions and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. So, go back, Psalms. When you dwell and wallow in transgression and iniquities, Bible calls you a fool. Fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. I told you, the affliction of your flesh has direct connection with sin, precious child of God. Next verse. Their souls abhorreth all manner of meat, and they draw near unto the gates of death. So, in other words, they have no control over their food. They, you know, gulp everything. Can we see this in NIV, Sean, verse 18? I want to see the word abhorreth. What is it? They loathe all food and drew near the gates of death. Itcharata kala, they are standing in the gates of death. No control. Okay? Verse 19. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble. Now, sugar has gone up, cholesterol is high, and obesity has set in. Now they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he saveth them out of their distress. You need to underline the word saveth. Next verse. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. So there are three things the Lord does: saves, heals, and delivers. Why they are in a misery? Because they didn't take care of their body. They have, it's like their body is like a junkyard. All kinds of food, all kinds of rubbish goes into the body. These eyes are not filtered. All kinds of rubbish. You know, the light of your body is your eye. All kinds of things you watch. All kinds of things goes through this eye. And when your body is dark, then it opens room for demonic activities. Oppression starts on your flesh when your body is dark. And darkness came because you were not controlling your eyes. You're not disciplined with your eyes. All kinds of junk goes through eye into your body. You watch from morning till evening on the phone, Netflix, that thing and this thing, and your eyes keep gorging in, you know, gulping in all sorts of junk, and it goes inside your body, and the light is snuffed out, and the body is full of dark, and the oppression of demonic oppression is on the outside. You know, when your body is full of light, precious child of God, demons stay away. Where there is light, there cannot be demons. They hate light, demons. So now your body is full of light because you're protecting your eyes. Now when your eyes keep eating all sorts of junk, your body turns into darkness, because the light of your body is your eyes, says the Bible. Mouth, all sorts of junk goes into your body. With your eyes, all sorts of junk goes into your body. You don't know how to protect your mouth. You don't know how to protect your eyes. Then you wonder, why am I sick, Pastor? I came to church, Pastor. I came, you laid hands and prayed for me, Pastor. Fasting and prayer time, I was there. But I didn't fast, Pastor, but I was there. Precious child of God, if you don't maintain your body, God will destroy your body. Because it is not yours. It belongs to Him. Watch out your eyes. Protect your body. Watch out your mouth. Protect your body. But when you cry out to God, there are three mercies of God. What? Saves, heals, and delivers. You know, God saves us from sin and heals us from sickness and delivers us from Satan. How He does it? He sent His word. He sent His word. So if you learn to listen and handle the word of God more with faith, you don't need a hand of a doctor. You don't need a hand of a pastor. You don't need a hand of anyone. If you learn to train your eyes to behold this word more, listen to me very carefully. Day and night, a man who meditates the word will be like a tree planted by the waters. Psalm 1, David says, have you seen a tree planted by the waters? Lush green, bearing fruits, bringing forth fruit. If you train your eyes to behold this word, not any junk, and if you train your mouth to speak the word, watch and see how your body appreciates. Watch and see how your body becomes healthy. The more you behold this word, your eyes beholding this word, and your mouth speaking this word, you will be like a tree planted by the waters. But it's so sad, precious children of God, how even children of God are trapped into the trend of this world. I'm preaching to myself as well. So watch out. Maintaining, taking care of your body is your responsibility. He sends forth His word. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 and 22. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 up to 22. It says, my son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them, and health to one's whole body. You need to underline these scriptures. Let's take it from verse 20 again, Sean. Watch this. My son, pay attention to what I say. Pay attention to what I say. Turn your ears to my words. Turn your ears. Now look, pay attention to my words. Turn your ears to this word what I say. Do not let them out of your sight. Meditate it. Don't lose it. Don't let it go out of your sight. Meditate it. Keep them within your heart. The more you see this, the more you meditate, it sinks into your heart, into your spirit. For they are life. What? Word of God. They are life to those who find them, and health to one's whole body. Are you with me? God sends forth His word and restores you. He saves you, heals you, and delivers you. So what is my responsibility towards my body? Sanctification. To see what is sanctification, it's to set something apart for God and make it holy. That's what sanctification means. What is sanctification? To set apart something for God and maintain it holy. So what is your responsibility and my responsibility towards our body is that we sanctify it and keep it holy for the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 3 to 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 3 to 5. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. Now you know God. You know God. So you're not a pagan. So what is Paul is saying? Let's take it from verse 3 again. Because you know God, it is God's will that you should be sanctified. What is sanctified? Separate something for God and maintain its holiness. That is sanctified. That you should avoid sexual immorality. That each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. Control your body, not in passionate lust like pagans. So this is what is your responsibility towards your body. So I want to leave this important word with you regarding your body is self-control. Self-control is the key. Self-control. Self-control is the key to keep your body sanctified. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 24 to 27. I'm just rushing a little bit because I want to finish the study today and make room for Devankar to come. Do you not know that in a race all runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the game goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly, but I do fight. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. So Paul is saying everyone who runs in a race, running not just for the sake of running, they are running to win a prize. Okay? So those of you who are running, you don't run aimlessly. You run to get a prize, a crown that is perishable. But Paul is saying, I am not running aimlessly. I am not just like beating a boxer who's just beating in the air. I am focused. I am aimed at getting a crown that is imperishable. In order to do that, he's saying, I give a blow to my body. I keep my body slave to my spirit man, who's a born again man, so that I will win the prize, that I will not get disqualified after preaching to the others. So precious child of God, in other words, listen to me, I'm almost done. Listen to me very carefully. In other words, Paul is saying, if you don't keep your body slave, if you don't beat your body, discipline your body and keep it under control, you can get disqualified. What? You can get disqualified. Paul is saying, I'm beating, See the word. I strike a blow to my body, B-O-D-Y, and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. So Paul is saying, if I don't discipline my body, if I don't beat and keep my body under control, if I don't keep my body under slave to my spirit man, I can get disqualified. Are you running to get disqualified? Am I running to get disqualified? That's the last thing that we want to happen. I don't want at the end of the race, God say, you're disqualified. Get out. No, I don't want to hear that. For that, I need to discipline my body. What is the use running for 30 years? I am a born-again Christian. I am spirit-filled Christian. I've been to church, you know, for all my life. You know, I am a preacher. I pastored Father's House Ministry. You know, I had so much of people following and blah, blah, blah. End of the race, God says, tumba body ek discipline kare na. Disqualified. What's the use? Paul, that's what Paul is saying. Think, precious people of God, how much you need to look at your body. It's not only spirit man. You know, today's preaching, people mostly focus on spirit and they just ignore the body. They're not even bothered about the body, but they don't understand how important the body is. If you don't take care of the body, if you don't discipline the body, if you don't beat the body and keep it a slave to the spirit man, you can get disqualified. That's how serious body is. I hope that you are receiving, precious child of God. So there is a serious responsibility on a committed Christian to discipline his or her body. Amen. So I think I have to finish here. Two more scriptures. Two more scriptures and then we'll close. I have 2 minutes ahead. Extra 2 minutes have already gone. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 16 and 17. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 16 and 17. Don't you know that you yourselves are a God's temple, and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. Serious verse. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, for God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple. So precious child of God, watch this. You cannot destroy another brother or sister. Watch this. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple. So precious child of God, you cannot destroy another temple of God. Are you with me? That's why you must look after one another. You must be there for one another. Don't destroy another brother or sister. God will destroy you because they are God's temple. That's how serious it is. When you are part of a church, when you are part of a church where there is another brother is God's temple, or another sister is God's temple, don't destroy them. Dangerous. God will destroy you. Last scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 29 and 30. In relation to this, I want to read that and close. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ, eat and drink judgment on themselves. This is why many among you are weak and sick, and number of you have fallen asleep. Fallen asleep means not putting a pillow and sleeping in the church. They have died. verse, let's go back 29, Sean. Now watch. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ. What is discerning the body of Christ? Discerning is not rightly discerning the body means you have strife against another brother or sister. You have unforgiveness against another brother or sister. You have racism. You have hard feelings. You have bitterness. You have anger towards another brother or sister. So now you, with all of these, you partake of communion. Okay? So in other words, because of the anger, because of the hatred and bitterness that you have towards another brother, you go and tarnish that brother or sister. You gossip and you slander. You say so many things about that brother or sister, and you do not know that brother or sister is a temple of the Holy Spirit. So what did the previous verse say? If you destroy God's temple, I will destroy you. So don't think you are the only temple of the Holy Spirit. All the other brothers, Sean is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Insa is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Fiji is the temple of the Holy Spirit. If I destroy them, God will destroy me. You are not only the person who holds the presence of the Holy Spirit of God. Understand that. So therefore, understand the seriousness of honoring and respecting and building every brother and sister in the church, not destroying them, not tearing them down, not breaking them. God will break you. So Paul is saying, some of you in the Corinthian church, you don't discern the body of Christ. In other words, he's saying you don't discern about other brothers and sisters who are part of the body of Christ. You don't discern and you partake of communion. And now some of you are sick. Some of you are, you know, weak. And some of you have fallen asleep. So very important how we look after each other, precious child of God. Amen. And I hope this study would have opened the eyes of you to show you how important our bodies are. Amen. And you can go study further. Not that I don't need to teach you. The Bible says the anointing within you teacheth you. So you have the anointing if you have the baptism of the Holy Spirit of God. And that anointing can teach you more about your body. So now you understand how important is your body. If you don't take care of this body properly, you can get disqualified. The primary responsibility of yours regarding the body is discipline it, keep it under control, and sanctify it through and through, and maintain the holiness for the Holy Spirit of God to happily live inside of you. Body is for the Lord, and the Lord is for the body. That's the primary cause of the creation of your body. To facilitate that, put your body every day as a living sacrifice on the altar. Amen. And you and I will finish well. God bless you. Thank you for being a part of this study. And next week we take a break. And first week of July we resume again the Wednesday and the Friday Bible study. Hoping to see all of you at the fasting and prayer time. Let's come together and pray and transform our churches, our nation, and the Father's House ministry. Amen. God bless you. Let us pray and close. Father, thank you for showing us the importance of how important our body is, Lord. Lord, we will not be negligent and ignorant of our bodies. Lord, even as I teach your children, I am convicted, Lord. Lord, we repent and we say sorry for mishandling our bodies. Father, forgive us. Have mercy on us. Save us. Lord, heal us and deliver our body. Save our body. Lord, heal our body and Lord, deliver our bodies. Lord, we'll protect our eyes from today, that our light, our body will be full of light, Lord. We will protect our mouth, that our bodies will be healthy. Lord, we will place our body on the altar. And Lord, sanctify it. Keep it separated unto you, holy and acceptable God. And thank you, Lord, that our bodies are going to appreciate in health from this moment onwards, because we are taking responsibility, serious responsibility, to maintain our bodies, O God. Father, give wisdom. Give wisdom to your children to, Lord, maintain their body. What to let go and what to incorporate. Teach them, Holy Spirit of God. Give them wisdom to, Lord, put into practice everything what you have taught and the convictions that you have brought to your children. And I believe with this word coming to you through the courtesy of the Holy Spirit of God, your bodies will start to appreciate. Your bodies will be healed. Your bodies will be restored. The damages that you did to your body because of your negligence and ignorance, the Lord forgives. And the Lord, as you repent and ask forgiveness from the Holy Spirit of God, he is going to release life into your body. That's what Paul says in Romans 8. He says that the Holy Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, and he will give you life. And today, as you repent and say, Lord, I'm sorry for mishandling my body. Lord, sorry for my negligence and ignorance. Now I will, Lord, beat my body, and I will discipline my body, and I will put it on the altar. And Lord, have a control over my body. Restore and Lord, rejuvenate and renew my body. Let it appreciate in health, Lord. Thank you, Father, Lord, for a new work that you're bringing in the bodies of your children. If your body is sick, I would ask you to ask forgiveness from God, saying, Lord, if I have mishandled my body, if I have ignorantly, Lord, negligently, I have mishandled my body. Lord, now I understand that my body does not belong to me, that you are the owner and that I am the steward. Lord, I'm sorry for taking ownership and doing whatever I want to do with my body. I repent. I repent this evening, God. Restore me. Restore the health of my body, Lord. Restore the strength of my body, God. Lord Jesus, I repent and ask for a restoration. And if you truly repent, the Lord will forgive, and the restoration begins today. And then from today, continue to discipline your body and sanctify it and present it to God every day, blameless and righteous and acceptable. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Have a blessed week. See you tomorrow at the fasting and prayer time. And see you on Sunday. God bless you. Oh,
Your spirit is a gentleman standing at my hidden doors within, where you wait for me to let you in, so you can set me free. Your spirit is a wrecking ball, tearing through my rebel walls, and one by one I watch them fall, till you are all I see.
You're with me too.